Want a break from the ads? Watch this short video to receive 30 minutes of ad-free music.
Introducing the all-new S'mores Frappuccino, now at Starbucks. This campfire classic is made with flavors of chocolate and marshmallow. Heat it up with the new S'mores Frappuccino, available for a limited time only.
It's free to play music in shuffle mode. If you'd like to play specific songs, just upgrade to Spotify Premium. Then you can listen to any song, anytime.
Check 1, 2.
Check 1.
Check 1, 2.
I won't dance, don't ask me. I won't dance, don't ask me. I won't dance, but damn with you. My heart won't let my feet do things they should do. You know what? You're lovely.
And so what? I'm lovely. On the shore, I feel so absolutely stumped on the floor.
When you dance, you're charming and you're gentle.
Especially when we do the continental.
But this feeling isn't truly mental.
For heaven rest us, we're not asbestos.
And that's why I won't dance. Why should I?
I won't dance. How could I?
I won't dance. Mercy. This feeling isn't purely mental.
Oh, really?
For heaven rest us, I'm not asbestos.
And that's why I won't dance. Why should I?
I won't dance. How could I?
I won't dance.
Merciful
cool.
I stop keeping track, talk myself in, I talk myself out, I get all worked up, then I let myself down. I tried so very hard not to lose it, I came up with a million excuses. I thought of every possibility, and I know someday that it'll all turn up. You'll make me work so we can work. So much more than I get. I just haven't met you yet. I might have to wait, I'll never give up. I guess it's half timing and the other half's luck. Wherever you are, whenever it's right, you'll come out of nowhere and into my life. And I know that we can be so amazing. And baby, your love is gonna change me.
Continue to enjoy your lunches. We're just going to get a couple of housekeeping things out of the way before we bring our speaker on. For those of you whom I have not met, I'm Karen Chavez, Chief of Staff to Dean Danzel here in the School of Medicine. Don't shush. This is the unimportant stuff. This is the maintenance stuff. So keep eating your meals and enjoying yourselves. I want to thank those of you. How many of you got to go to the icebreaker on Wednesday? I was homesick and just hated that I wasn't there, but I heard it was a lot of fun. It was a great gathering. So I want to thank those of you who were able to get out, to come out and help break the ice. And we're going to continue to do things that will help us better connect with each other and improve our understanding within the school and our knowledge and information sharing. Next month's program, the June SMART program, will be on June 24th. The topic is on mentoring. The speaker is Dr. Gayton Jean-Marie from the School of Education. It will be the kickoff for our mentoring program. We are going to start here in the School of Medicine for staff. The topic is Mentoring Matters. Keep an eye out. The mentoring committee has worked really hard. Where are my mentoring chairs? Are they here? I don't have my glasses on. The mentoring committee's worked really hard to put together a great mentoring program that's going to kick off in September. So Dr. Gayton Jean-Marie is going to talk about mentoring in June and why mentoring is important in career development and professional development. Let's see. After these programs, you'll receive an email. For everyone that registers, we send a follow-up email asking for you to evaluate the programs. This is very important information for us because it helps us determine future program content and speakers. It lets us know whether the lunches are working or whether you have other issues, and it gives you an opportunity to provide some input on topics that you'd like to see for future programs. So please make sure that you respond to those surveys when they come out. They're real short. It's probably 5 or 6 questions. It will take you about 10 seconds to complete the survey and get it back to us. It's very important. You did receive a survey as you came in today for the from the Office of Medical Education. If you are a faculty, I guess, Susan, it's for faculty should complete this one. Or anyone who wants to. If you get this survey completed, please, and we will try to combine our surveying information. Today we're going to have an opportunity to ask questions at the end of the program. And so there are microphones positioned here in the aisles. And if you have a question, we ask if you would try to get to a microphone. If you're in the middle and sort of landlocked and can't get to a microphone, if you'll speak up nice and loudly so that we can repeat your question so that everyone can hear it, we'd appreciate it. But there are microphones for your use. And if you are a person that tends to ask questions, please sit near the microphones than not. I'd like to thank a couple of people for the work they've done today to get us here. Blair Cade, where are you, Blair? And Melody Kitchen, there she's at the top. And the program committee chairs are always working so hard. Blair Cade and Melody Kitchen are the co-chairs for the programming committee for SMART, and they are instrumental in making sure that these programs come to you every month. But I would be remiss if I didn't thank a certain young lady that works really, really hard on these programs every month. She's probably out front now, but Anna Shawfont. I want to thank her for the work that she does to make sure that all the lunches get here and that you get what you ordered and that the registration happens and everything goes off without a hitch. So if you see Anna out and about, just remember to say thanks because her good work helps make sure this happens. I also like to thank Stephanie Barnett and Susan Sonning. Susan's down here in the front. And Stephanie is right there, too. Also, I don't have my glasses on, so I can't even see. Both of you for your great work in getting our speaker here with us today. And with no further ado, then I will introduce our speaker. And I'm going to tell you right now, with this cold and with big words like anesthetist, I can say it if I say it really slowly, and New Zealand words, good luck to me. Our speaker today, I'm very excited to have him here. His name is Dr. Robin Youngson, and he's going to bring a topic that's focused primarily on clinical care, but his points regarding compassion and renewal from burnout are applicable to all of our professional pursuits. So I think as you hear the message today, think of the application for you in your own professional sense. Dr. Youngson was the clinical leader of the Waitakere, I got that one right, I think, Hospital in Auckland, New Zealand. He graduated from Cambridge University with honors in engineering. His work in oral exploration later funded his medical education at the School of Medical Sciences at the University of Bristol. He finished medical school with honors and became a fellow of both the Royal College of Anesthetists of England and Australian and New Zealand College of Anesthetists. He became the pioneering physician of the Child Flight Pediatric Air Ambulance Service in New Zealand and began his consulting work at Auckland Hospital in 1994. Dr. Youngson has been closely involved in patient process redesign and quality improvement. The healthcare reforms of the 1990s led him to issues of leadership when he founded CLANZ, C-L-A-N-Z, stands for the Clinical Leaders Association of New Zealand, in order to return professional values to public health care. In the last 10 years, Dr. Youngson has worked with a visionary team of managers and professionals in the development of the new Waitakere Hospital. Dr. Youngson was the acting chair of the National Health Epidemiology and Quality Assurance Advisory Committee, EPIQUAL, and an inaugural member of the International Steering Committee for the new World Health Organization Collaborating Center on Patient Safety. He has presented and taught widely on issues of clinical service redesign, patient-centered reform, clinical leadership, patient safety, open disclosure, and compassion in healthcare. He's also the author of the book, Time to Care, How to Love Your Patients and Your Job, and I'm reading it right now. It's a great book. With no further ado, he's an exciting speaker. We're delighted to have him with us today, Dr. Robin Youngson.
Karen, thank you very much for the warm introduction. I'm just mindful that if you're on the faculty of the staff of the School of Medicine, you're probably exhausted right now. I understand you've been going through a hard process in the last week or so with accreditation, and it sounds like that's going to be okay, and you can all begin to relax a bit. So just mindful of the stress you've been under, and so appreciative that you're taking time out to attend my lecture today. Some of you may have heard me speak before and will have heard some of the evidence I'm going to present, but I reminded myself what was on the flyer, what I promised to speak about, because by tomorrow we'll be getting up to about 60 different engagements, formal presentations, workshops, meetings, lectures in Louisville and surrounding cities in the last 5.5 weeks. So I'm having trouble remembering what we promised. But I'm going to go through some of the slides quickly to share with those of you who hadn't heard it before the really remarkable scientific evidence that's showing how important compassionate care is. But I really want to reflect on the issue of burnout, of self-care, of what we need to do to really nurture healthcare at its current state and time. I'm aware I'm a little fatigued. If I miss a slide or get confused, then just bear with me, we'll get through it. I guess that compassion is the reason that almost every one of you are in this audience. That's the humane quality of understanding suffering and wanting to respond to it. It's much more than a feeling, it's a motivation. And that's probably why all of you have chosen to be in careers in healthcare. If I look at medical science from a kind of global perspective, what we're seeing is a kind of industrialization of healthcare. And the medical science is very objective and materialistic and reductionist. It's not focused on patients so much as disease processes. And when I think about how we are as health professionals, sometimes I think we've just become mere body mechanics trying to fix bits of the patient rather than healers, which is a term not easy to use in modern day medicine, but is something deeper. It's about caring for the whole person. But in healthcare, we have what I call a caring crisis, with rates of burnout that are really catastrophic. In the USA, it's about 30 to 40% of nurses. It's about 50% of physicians. Depends on how old you are and what specialty you're in. And if you have burnout, it has these characteristics. It's emotional exhaustion. It's depersonalization, so you turn into a robot. It's becoming cynical about your work. It's having little sense of personal accomplishment. So that at the end of the day, you go home feeling you haven't done very much for your patients. And this is a physiological state that's represented in brain states and the biology of our whole being that means it's quite impossible to sustain compassionate caring if that's the physiological state you're in. I see some people taking notes. I just want to let you know that all these slides are going to be shared freely, and you can take the slides, adapt them, borrow them, put your logo on them, share them, make them your own, whatever. So please don't feel the need to take notes. Now, what is the consequence of health professionals in larger and larger numbers are not able to care? What we've known from some personal and painful experience is that if you're in hospital for a long time, for many months, you really remember very little of what the doctor says at all. And you don't remember that much of what even happened to you, but the emotional experiences of care will stay with you for a lifetime, for good or for bad. And those have a very powerful biological effect on the patient, and I want to share some of the evidence for how emotional and psychological well-being impacts on health outcomes. But first of all, I just want to touch on the neuroscience of interpersonal connection. When I went to medical school, it was all about clinical detachment, being objective, not having any kind of emotional connection to patients. I'm pleased to say that modern neuroscientists now tell us that that state does not exist. And indeed, the ancient traditions like Buddhism have known that for thousands of years. And that I now know that as a physician, I have to be extraordinarily careful about the thoughts, the feelings, the spirit, and the intention that I bring to every patient encounter, because within minutes, that's changing the biology of the patient. And as an anesthesiologist, I see this very plainly because I have a nervous patient comes into the OR, we hook up the vital signs monitors, the heart rate's 120, the blood pressure's 190, and the quality of presence I bring will either make that heart rate and blood pressure go up or settle down, even before I've said a word or injected a drug. It's a powerful effect. So if we can bring a compassionate, thoughtful, mindful presence to our patients, we can trigger off a biological reaction which includes good genes switching on, new proteins being synthesized, enhancing healing, enhancing immunity, dampening down the dangerous inflammatory responses, stress responses, blood pressure, cortisol, those kinds of things, and leaving a positive emotional memory. And every time the patient recalls that memory again, that precious moment of caring, this whole biological cascade turns on again. But if we're really grumpy and burnt out and frustrated and angry and judging, then patients do not have clinical detachment. And we actually physically wound our patients. And we turn on bad genes and we inhibit the immune system and systems of healing. And we're turning on a lot of quite dangerous inflammatory mediators and stress responses. And we're again leaving an emotional experience that may be remembered for years. And every time the patient recalls that, these bad biological effects. Now, if you had told me this 5 years ago, I would have laughed you out of the room. I mean, I began my career as an engineer, I became a doctor, I became an anesthesiologist. You know, I was a scientist, I was a rationalist, and I wouldn't have believed any of this woo-woo stuff. But I want to share some with you some of the extraordinary evidence that's letting us know that this is, actually, in fact, literally true. This is a study in the Netherlands, 1,000 people who survived a heart attack. They were followed up for 15 years. Who had another heart attack, who had a stroke, who survived, who died. In the course of their rehab, they did a psychological evaluation. There's a group here, the happy optimists, a middle group, and the pessimists. The pessimists over the next 15 years had 4 times the mortality rate. That's an astonishing difference. That's for cardiac causes of death. Because if we have a patient with this risk factors and we put them on triple medication with a beta blocker and an aspirin and a cholesterol drug, we reduce their risk by about 40 to 50%. This is an effect size dramatically bigger. It doesn't only apply to the cardiac disease. For all causes of death, including cancer, it was a 3-fold increase in mortality. Here's another illustration. Turns out medical students will do anything if you pay them enough money. In this study, they all agreed to have live influenza virus injected into the nose and throat. I hope they were well paid. Hardly any of the optimists got flu, and almost all of the pessimists got flu. And the odds ratio was 3-1. That's astonishing. We spend so much time in hospital trying to prevent our patients getting infections in the hospital, and we govern gland up, and we put patients in a side room. And I wonder sometimes what it feels like to be a patient when the only people who come to see you don't even touch you with a bare hand, have got a mask and gloves and gown, and treat you as some kind of pariah that is dangerous and infected and can't be touched. And maybe if we were to wash our hands carefully and sit on a bed and hold hands, that might reduce the chances of infection more than all the protective gear. Burnout, I started to talk about that. This is a study in Israel, 8,000 people, and these are not old people, these are working class people in their 20s, 30s, 40s, 50s, 60s. They did the Maslach burnout inventory. If you're above the threshold for burnout, you have a 40% increased risk of a heart attack in the next 5 years. That is a bigger risk than smoking. It's a bigger risk than having high cholesterol. If you're extreme on the burnout score, as many of our physicians are in the USA, you nearly double your risk of those events. Here's another illustration from the new science of epigenetics. We're learning that the kind of stories with the little voice in the head that gives a running commentary on how we're doing in the world, that the deeper stories and assumptions and beliefs we have, our thoughts and feelings are actually powerfully modulating our gene expression. This is a study of patients with borderline personality disorder. They've been traumatized in childhood. As a result of that, they turn off a very essential gene that makes a growth factor called brain-derived neurotrophic factor. If you don't have that protein, your brain does not develop normally. If you do a functional MRI scan, these brains are disordered. They're not wired up correctly. These patients cannot regulate emotion. They have chaotic lives with high rates of self-harm and suicide. There's a form of group psychotherapy called dialectical behavior therapy. Those patients who stay the course, there's more than an 80% cure rate. No drugs, no surgery. If you do the epigenetic analysis again, they're no longer methylating this gene. They've turned the gene on. The protein levels rise. The brain structurally heals itself. Our thoughts, feelings, beliefs are governing our gene expression, which governs our long-term risk of many different kinds of disease. So for a long time, being a great advocate of patient-centered care, I thought we needed patient-centered care to treat the disease conditions our patients have. I now think that's a little mistaken, and that we actually, what we need now is compassion-centered care to help our patients heal. Because the things that we do as physicians, our medicines, our interventions, might only have really quite a small amount of effect on the patient's outcomes, and the patient's capacity of healing is something that's really important. I want to share some striking evidence of just how powerful that effect is. This is a study in Italy, 20,000 insulin-dependent diabetics. They had to rate their own family doctor, is this a high-empathy doctor or a low-empathy doctor? If the patients belonged to a high-empathy doctor, they had 42% fewer admissions, acute admissions to hospital in the next year. That's a remarkable result. I like presenting this data to quality improvement institutes because I say, do you have any quality improvement interventions that reduce admissions by 42%? And they look embarrassed. And yet just having an empathetic doctor is one example. This is a study, a randomized controlled trial of early access to palliative care in patients with terminal lung cancer. That's a wise, compassionate physician or nurse specialist who's going to talk to you about life goals. If you have 9 to 12 months to live, how are you going to live that life to the fullest? What are your goals? What's important to you? How can we reduce your symptoms as opposed to let's schedule you for the next round of chemotherapy? The patients that had that support had much better quality of life, dramatically less depression. They made very different decisions about care. They're turning down the chemotherapy, the radiotherapy. Thanks, doctor. I want to have the chemotherapy. I'm too busy. I want to go and see my grandson. Even though palliative care was an additional cost funded on top of all the other care that was funded, and they were fully funded for access to all medical care, the total cost of care fell. That's, for me, that would be a pretty good trade-off. I'm going to trade off survival time for quality of life if I don't have long to live. But these patients actually survive 30 to 40% longer than those who had all the aggressive medical treatment. This is compassionate whole person care based on the needs of the patient life that achieves better outcomes, reduced interventions, reduced cost, and prolonged survival. This is the only study I can find that has in the title Randomized Controlled Trial of Compassionate Care. It's a study in the United States in an ER of 127 homeless people presenting in a series. And they were randomized so that all had usual medical care, but only half of them had compassionate care. What was that intervention that they randomized? It was a volunteer sitting and talking with the patient for half an hour. That was it. That led to a 30% reduction in repeat presentations to the ER. That's really surprising to me. I think if I was homeless, I'd like to be in a nice, warm, dry place, have a cup of tea and a sandwich, have someone sit down and talk with me. But no, it did something about their resilience. It kept them out of the ER. This is one of my favorite studies, but it was published 51 years ago. It's a really well-designed, randomized controlled trial from one of the Harvard hospitals. It's about the manner in which the anesthesiologist did the pre-op consult. They were either asked to do it in a purely clinical fashion or, regardless of character, and randomized half of the patients to give it in a more supportive way, to be caring, to be compassionate, to tell the patient how confident they were that they're going to make a great recovery and what a great team is looking after them and some of the things they could do to enhance their recovery. So randomized control trial, that 5 minutes of caring from the anesthesiologist is the only difference in care. It halved the dose of morphine in the 5 days post-op. It knocked nearly 3 days off the length of stay. These very tiny interventions in compassionate caring are having a biological effect that lasts days or weeks or years afterwards. Helen Reese at Harvard, she's the world authority on empathy in medical practice. Her group has done a meta-analysis, like a Cochrane review, of the best randomized controlled trials. So if you invest in the quality of doctor-patient relationship, how much does it affect outcomes? They've figured out that an empathetic doctor will reduce your 5-year risk of a heart attack more than being on a statin, a cholesterol drug. Well, we spend in the world $29 billion a year on statins. I think the drug companies don't want us to know this evidence, but having an empathetic doctor is a more important way of reducing your risk factor. This is not a study. It's a study by Ernst & Young, the big consulting company, into what happened into home care in the Netherlands. home care nurses that are caring for patients in the community. It used to be a highly task-driven system where they had screwed down to the ultimate level of efficiency where they'd worked out that it would take you 12 minutes to do a dressing change and 15 minutes to do this, and the nurses were given a list of tasks, and they were held accountable for their time in minutes and their dollars spent, and all the nurses were burning out. Well, one person got a contract to look after a small community, hired 12 nurses and said, I'm going to put you in a completely autonomous team with no manager, no leader. You're smart people. You can figure out how to provide the best care to these patients. Pretty soon there was a second team and a third team. And within 6 years, this had expanded to 7,000 nurses covering three quarters of all home nursing care in the whole country of the Netherlands. Still with no managers, no bosses. They have a head office with only 30 staff. What were the outcome measures? Well, the nurses who work for this organization 3 years running have voted this is the best employer in the whole of the country, not just in healthcare. The patients served by these nurses ranked the quality of care 9.1 out of 10 on average. That's the highest score of any health service in the Netherlands. And Ernst & Young went in and discovered that the productivity had improved 40%. There was substantial cost savings. The patients were getting better in half the time, and they reduced by one-third the number of admissions to ER. This is compassionate whole-person care that's not driven by a bean counter in terms of tasks. This is smart professionals allowed to be autonomous, allowed to be caring, allowed to build relationships, allowed to take the time to care. That's just so much more productive. Now, all of us in healthcare know that just demand is overwhelming. We spend so much trying to limit demand. But that's only if you're in the role of being a body mechanic. And if you step into the role of being a healer, what you actually discover is that every single patient is not a burden on your service, not a demand on your service, that every single human being is an abundant resource of strength, of resilience, of healing and well-being. If only we bring our knowledge and skills in the service of the patient's life as opposed to just superimposing our idea of what the clinical agenda should be. And I want to remind you of that extraordinary capacity that every human being has for healing. If you have a badly smashed ankle like this, the orthopedic surgeon will fix it. Well, actually, the orthopedic surgeon doesn't. The orthopedic surgeon screws the bones together so that they're straight and then stitches up the wound, and the bone heals itself. In fact, orthopedic is just Greek for two words. It's straight foot. That's all it means. So I'm sorry if I'm offending any orthopedic surgeon in the audience. But we just need to remember that our interventions as physicians, as nurses, are kind of... I'm going to change that. Our interventions as physicians maybe are limited. Nurses bring compassionate care. Maybe can do more than the doctors in terms of the patient's healing. When a bowel surgeon cuts out a tumor and sutures the ends of the bowel together, a week later you go back, you can't find the join except for where the sutures are. And yet if you cut your garden hose at home and if you suture it with interrupted sutures and then turn the water on, the water sprays everywhere. A garden hose does not heal itself. A human bowel does. A patient can present with a lung full of pus, no air in the lung at all. And we give antibiotics, and we give oxygen, we give supportive therapies, but a month later, the lung is completely normal in structure. That's the human capacity for healing. The antibiotic did not do that. Now, there's something that's really embarrassing for medicine, and that is that we send patients home with terminal cancer, we've run out of options for treatment, and the patient doesn't die. It's really embarrassing for medicine. And 15 years later, they're still alive. And we're so embarrassed about that that we're not curious. We haven't researched these cases. We kind of kept them hidden. But nonetheless, there's a group here in the States that have been scouring the medical literature. And in 800 journals have found 3,500 cases, fully documented, the CT scans, everything, fully worked up, where patients who should have died with advanced terminal disease did not. And I just want to remind you that this is this extraordinary capacity for healing. And this group have been studying the characteristics of these patients because should we not be curious? What is this amazing capacity for healing? What could we do as physicians, as nurses, to support that capacity for healing? And I think the answer actually is compassion. In the research from my book, Time to Care, I've written a whole chapter on the healing power of touch. There's just an extraordinary number of randomized controlled trials showing that that a healing touch from a human being, whether it's just holding a hand or doing massage or therapeutic touch or lots of different modalities, just can dramatically reduce pain and fatigue in patients with cancer post-surgery. Therapeutic touch, if you take 100 medical students who are anemic because they don't eat a great diet, and you do a randomized control trial, and half of them have therapeutic touch and half of them don't, then the control group, the hemoglobin, doesn't change, and the treatment group, it goes up in a clinically significant amount. I mean, there are just really remarkable studies showing that human touch is healing. What we also know is that if the physician has the capacity not to set their own agenda, but to really connect to the patient, to build that rapport, to bring their knowledge and skills in the service of the patient's concerns, that dramatically reduces the number of interventions that you would plan to do downstream. So a six-fold reduction in laboratory tests, a 2.5-fold reduction in the number of specialist referrals. And these patients, even though they had fewer tests and fewer referrals, they recovered quicker. They had better outcomes. It also has a profound effect on costs of care. So this is a similar study where 509 patients, every single consultation was videotaped. They analyzed every 10-second block as this centered on the concerns of the patient or the concerns of the patient. And they ranked the patient from 0% patient-centered care up to 100% patient-centered care. And then they split them in two equal groups. If you're below the median, the total costs of care in the whole healthcare system are 50% higher. This is the major driver of cost in our healthcare system, is the ability of the physician not to set their own agenda, but to serve the life of the patient. But as I alluded to before, we have this crisis in caring. And if so many of our health professionals are burning out, you know, what can we do about this? And when we've been to 15 different countries in our work trying to bring more compassion and humanity to healthcare. And in every country, we're seeing high rates of burnout and the sense of helplessness. Everyone's just so exhausted, fatigued, and they feel like a tiny little cog in a big machine. So what can we do? But one of the things I've learned, and I want to share a personal story, is that actually every single one of us has extraordinary power to change the whole world around us. And the answer to that is to shift your own attitude to the world. And I want to take some time to share a story to explain that. As I said, I began my career as an engineer, I became a doctor, I became an anesthesiologist. I got a job in the biggest hospital in New Zealand. I was pretty enamored of my heroic status. I could save any patient, I could do high-tech medicine in the OR, the ICU, and perhaps I'd lost some of my humanity in that long process of training. And the kind of... We brutalize our young professionals. That's really the only word for it. People have talked about the hidden curriculum in medical school that reduces the empathy of medical students in their years of training, and then we throw them in the deep end as interns with little emotional support. And the same is true of nurses. So I think through that process, I'd really begun to forget my purpose as a physician, and I vividly remember the day when I remembered it again. On that day, I was the on-call anesthesiologist for a busy maternity unit. It was a hospital that, by accident of history and geography, had no residents. So as the senior staff member, I was called for every IV that a midwife couldn't do, for every patient consultation, for every epidural, for every C-section, and I was on duty for 24 hours, and it was sometimes very fatiguing. And on this particular day, I'd had a long day. I'd worked about 15 hours. I got home at 11 o'clock at night, having worked pretty much flat out since 8 o'clock in the morning. I had my dinner then. Marith had cooked me a beautiful dinner. It was a bit dried out, having been in the oven for the last 4 hours, but was still very tasty. And I fell asleep completely exhausted at midnight. At 1 a.m. I was called out again to perform an epidural for pain relief in a mother in labor. So I went to the hospital, I performed that, made sure she was safe, it was effective, came home about 2 a.m., I slept for 30 minutes. At 2:30, I was called again for an urgent C-section. There was fetal distress. I had to rush into the hospital. I had to tend to the mother and baby. They both survived that. It took me 2 hours. So at 4:30, I returned to bed, even more exhausted and now sleep-deprived. I slept for only 10 minutes, and the phone rang again. I was beating the life out of the alarm clock, wondering why it wouldn't stop ringing. And Mary was saying, "For God's sake, Robin, answer the phone." because in that confusional state, I didn't know where I was and what was going on, because I'd only been asleep for 10 minutes and fallen into that very deep sleep. And it was the midwife calling me back to do another epidural, and I was really pissed off. I was really workable because, you know, it's midwives and doctors have a kind of different worldview. And midwives, it's all about childbirth as a natural process, and they don't really like doctors and interventions and drugs and needles and everything else. They want to keep the doctors out of the room. So that as an anesthesiologist, sometimes when I was called to the labor room, it was not a very welcome reception, because this mother's now figured out that it hurts, really. And then, and they want an epidural, and the midwife didn't want that to happen, and, you know, it was a bit of friction and difficulty. So when this stupid midwife allowed me to go home and sleep 10 minutes when I was so exhausted and then called me back in, I was really pissed off. And I was driving to hospital feeling extremely sorry for myself, very fatigued, and really workable. I was in such a bad mood. And halfway to the hospital, I suddenly felt really ashamed. I really felt ashamed. Because in that moment, I don't know what spirit or presence came to me, but in that moment I remembered my purpose. I remembered why I became a physician. I remembered the calling for me was compassion, that humane capability to understand suffering and want to do something about it. I remembered that this was an invitation to be part of an intimate, of a really intimate event, that of childbirth. You know, how many of us in this world are invited to be part of something so intimate and precious, that to know what I could do as an anesthesiologist could completely transform the experience of that mother. Not only could I relieve the pain, but I could take a lot away the fear and suffering. So in that moment of shame, I made a promise to myself that I would try a thought experiment, that if ever I mindfully caught myself with these thoughts in my head that were about being grumpy and tired and angry, that I would displace those thoughts and I would choose to reflect on the extraordinary privilege of the invitation we have every single day for those precious human moments of connection, and I would attempt to dwell on that. So I tried that for 3 months as a thought experiment, and something really interesting happened. The whole world changed. All of the grumpy midwives had a personality transplant. And then when I knocked on the door of the labor room, I'd be welcoming them like a hero. And I'd had this sense that they'd say to the mother, "You're so lucky, there's the best anesthesiologist on duty, and he's so kind, and his epidurals are the best." And I would get introduced to everyone. And the epidural trolley would be ready there in the labor room, and the mother would be in the position for the epidural ready. And I'd do the injection in about 5 minutes, and the pain would go away, and I'd kind of go, you know, feel like a hero. And I noticed something else. I noticed that if I was really careful with the quality of spirit that I brought into that labor room, because here's a mother that's completely exhausted, hasn't slept, in severe pain, run out of coping strategies, and everyone's really tense. And then if I brought softness and gentleness and compassion out of that room, then half the pain would go away before I even put a needle in the back of the patient. And the pain relief would work better, and the complication rate would be less, and the number of C-sections was going down, and the number of call-outs I had in the night was getting less. And the whole world changed around me. And I thought, wow, that was amazing, because the only person who changed was me. And it gave me this enormous sense of power. I can change the whole world if I decide to be responsible for my own attitude. Now, the midwives probably thought I'd had a personality transplant too, but who knows. So in even the most stressed hospitals, there are some people who come to work with a smile on their face. And they have this big bubble of stillness and calm around them, and it kind of moves with them, kind of like a ballet. And they always find time for the human connection, and they always find time for that compassion and caring. And the things that frustrate and irritate the rest of us, they seem to be immune to that. And they go home at the end of the day still with a smile on their face. Damn it, don't you hate people like that? And what have they got? How come they're joyful? How come they're joyful and flourishing when the rest of us are burning out? And so we began to study those people. We started to collect stories. We began to study learn the research in positive psychology about what are the personal attributes of those people who manage to be resilient and flourishing and joyful in a system that's making the rest of us go crazy. They certainly choose their attitude. They choose to reflect on the extraordinary privilege of the work they do. A few days ago, we met a doctor who works in St. Joseph's Clinic. It's a free clinic for the uninsured. There's 200 volunteers give their time, physicians, nurses, therapists, managers, volunteers, just give their time for nothing, and there's no money changes hand at all. And they were some of the most joyful practitioners we'd ever met. And they said, if every single patient pays us, they pay us handsomely, but they pay us with gratitude. They pay us with their willingness to open their lives to us, to allow the human connection, to allow us to be compassionate. And they practice simple medicine because they don't have any access to CT scanners or diagnostics. So they, you know, the physician had a stethoscope around his neck, and he's got a simple point-of-care blood test lab, and that's it. They just have to use clinical medicine and listen to patients, listen to their story and examine them and make a diagnosis and offer some simple treatments. And they're among the happiest treatments, the happiest practitioners that we met. Of course, they don't have to deal with insurance companies, so that probably helped. The people who come that are really joyful in their work, they're very deliberate in their intention. They come with an intention to do small acts of kindness every single day. They practice a lot of appreciation and gratitude. They're compassionate towards themselves. In the Western world, we tend to have a very critical, explanatory style. This little voice in their head that's giving a running commentary on how life is going tends to be overly critical. We would never say to other people what we say to ourselves. So if we can learn to be kind to ourselves, to nourish ourselves, we're kinder to the rest of the world. They do things to look after their health and well-being, work-life balance, exercise, stress relief. They learn the skills of mindfulness. They let go of being the expert. They bring their knowledge and skills in the service of the patient's life and allow the patient to make a decision. They attend to the spiritual growth. And these are the kinds of things that really allow these people to be flourishing. And you don't need permission from anyone to adopt any of these practices. In November last year, there was a whole week of conferences about compassion. We heard the latest research around empathy and compassion. And we heard a term that we found really helpful, which is called flexible empathy. Now, as an anesthesiologist, there would be occasions when I'm called down to resus, in the next 4 minutes, I've got to save a patient's life. I have to be absolutely ruthlessly focused on the quick series of tasks and diagnosis and procedures that I've got to do in the next 4 minutes to save a life. And I can't afford to have any emotions clouding my judgment. And when I do that successfully and the patient survivor has gone to ICU, I then have to meet with the family. And this is a traumatized, fearful family that's seen their loved one critically ill, nearly died. So I then have to turn off my clinical detachment and I have to turn on my compassion and empathy and be fully present and really caring for that family. And I need the qualities of mindfulness that allow me to at one time be absolutely razor focused on some technical tasks and analysis, another time to bring my empathy and compassion. And that ability to switch your empathy and your mindfulness to different attention, to different targets, is really helpful in being resilient. Because if you're just empathetic all the time, you're going to burn out. If you're just a rationalist, materialist all the time, your patients will find you cold and unempathetic. So it's the ability to shift your attention is important. Also at that conference, we heard the latest research that we can heal our own lives. There's a cluster of 53 genes called CTRA. These genes are the most important genes for all of our inflammatory mediators. If a human being is stressed or threatened or unwell, we turn on these genes. There's a whole cascade of inflammatory mediators. As an acute response, that's appropriate. If we keep turning these on, it's extremely dangerous. This is the major risk factor for arterial disease, for cardiac disease, for cancer, and for neurodegenerative disorders. Now, it turns out that the kind of lives we lead can upregulate or downregulate these genes. And if we lead a life of pursuing materialistic happiness, hedonic happiness as the Greek called it, then we upregulate these genes and we make ourselves prone to chronic disease. If we lead a life of virtue, of compassion, of caring, of selflessness, of service, turns out that we downregulate these genes and we turn off all these inflammatory mediators. And all of us know that 80-year-old community volunteer is just full of energy, has never had a day in hospital and just thrives, and that's the life of service. So as health professionals, providers, as healers, I think we need to attend to our own happiness and well-being. And if we can connect to the heart of our work and bring ourselves in service, then that makes our lives full and it protects us from a lot of chronic disease. And then we have something to offer our patients. So how do we help our patients to heal? It's through our compassion. It's the humane quality of understanding their suffering, the capacity to be present, to listen to that. And the meaning of healing is to transcend suffering. But if we have not transcended our own suffering, as we as health professionals are all burnt out, if we're all completely stressed out, if we're not connected to our ideals, our values, our hopes, our aspirations, the compassion, the quality of compassion that brought us into our work, then we are going to suffer stress and depression and burnout and chronic ill health and chronic disease. And are we going to role model the kind of health and well-being that our patients need? So I think the job of the healer is to attend first to your own healing. You all right? Do you need some water? And if we can attend to our own healing, and if we discover that capacity, then it means that we can believe in every single one of our patients. We can believe in the extraordinary capacity of every single one of our patients to heal their own lives. And that's why it's so important that we take care of our own and we attend to our own healing. Here are three books that are just, I find, really useful resources to help me on my journey, my 15, 20-year journey. Learned Optimism is about questioning the thoughts in your head and replacing them with more realistic thoughts. That powerfully enhances your performance in any endeavor, yeah, any human endeavor. Positivity is one of the very good books about the whole new science of positive psychology. Krista Neff, she's the world authority on self-compassion. So I commend to you these books as resources. Here in Louisville, instead of measuring the burnout score, we've invented a new survey instrument that measures the joy and satisfaction you get from compassionate caring and working in a supportive environment. Because if we measure the things we're aspiring to, we're likely to see more of those. If we keep measuring burnout, we're going to drive ourselves into more burnout. So I invite you to try out this test. And just to let you know that everything that I've spoken about is evidence-based. These are all research studies published in major peer-reviewed journals, and the science is really strong on that. If you want to learn more, my book, Time to Care, we have a few copies left. We got a whole bunch printed for 6 weeks ago, and we have a few left. The proceeds for that just go to support our work. It's $20. There's 200 references in that book. And this is the movement we founded. 4 years ago, Marith and I, we quit our jobs. We sold our house, we downsized, and we made a commitment to this work, and it's taken us to many different countries around the world. And we're seeing exactly the same issues, whether it's in the USA, New Zealand, Australia, Saudi Arabia, the Netherlands, Norway, Hong Kong, wherever. It's really the same issues, no matter the culture. I want to take a moment now just to reflect on the last 5 weeks. I have no slides for this, no script. We're approaching a count of 60 in terms of presentations and workshops and meetings and discussions in 5 weeks. It's been a very full schedule. And we've done about 20 workshops, which are really tender experiences of sitting with health professionals, sharing very deep stories of connection. Some of those really stick out in the mind, in our memories. In Bloomington, we were in a small group of nurses in this workshop process. And to allow really attentive listening, we have a carved wooden heart, which we use like a talking stick. So only the person holding the heart is allowed to speak, and everyone else sits in absolute silence listening to the stories. And it's a wonderful way to enhance listening. And there was a nurse there, stepped forward and picked up the heart. And she didn't speak. She held it to her own heart. And then she bent right over. And she wept for 2 minutes. And everyone else in the room, including myself, wept with her. And she wept with the pain and the grief of working in a healthcare system that didn't reward and encourage her desire to be a deeply compassionate nurse. that was so focused on productivity and tasks and checklists and everything else. So she wept for the grief of that. And she wept also with joy, because she'd found many ingenious ways of kind of bending the rules and being the kind of nurse she wanted to be. She was a compassion rebel, which is a term we've just heard in the last few days. And she wept for the joy of that as well. And then she shared some stories and told us that all of our suffering has a purpose. It's to help us to be more compassionate, to teach us deep lessons. And then she concluded, she said, the giver and the receiver are one. It was a really profound statement, that every act of compassion is very deeply an act of compassion for ourselves as well as for the patient or the family member. That will sustain us, that will grow our hearts. And that really stays with me. Now, Meredith and I, we've given up 6 weeks of our life to be here in Louisville. It's our fourth visit. That has been exhausting. That has been a pretty major commitment in our lives. There was a lot of planning. Grateful thanks to Stephanie Barnett, who just put that schedule together for us. We promised we'd come for 6 weeks and do our best to serve this community and freely give our time to any individual organization that wanted to hear this message. And we've been overwhelmed by the number of people who want to hear that. And many places that in previous years were not receptive, did not want us in the building, now inviting us in. So we're sensing this big field change. And I've been fairly attached to an idea that somehow out of this, we're going to achieve something. We're going to make a difference, that my time would not be wasted. And I've been working hard on trying to let go of that attachment and to really put the onus on this community to rise up and to take these ideas and take these passions and take this intention and create something out of us that's going to be around taking care of our own. In a moment, I'm going to ask Stephanie Barnett to speak something about just how we're getting that organized, and there's a critical event tomorrow, which is just a chance for you to engage in that whole debate. But I want to share with you one symbolic image that keeps coming back to me. On a previous visit, we had an idea that maybe we should create some kind of center for compassionate healing and happiness of all who work in healthcare. We could find an old building in the city, an empty building, and get a whole pile of volunteers and make it nice and run a whole series of programs and courses and workshops and healing retreats. And that may be something that will happen, but we're not going to suggest any ideas. But we're in a conversation about a week ago, and someone said, you know what, there are so many empty churches sitting in the city center. Maybe someone would give you one of those. And I thought of these big old stone buildings, and I thought about how hot it's been in the last week or two and how it would be so nice to be in the cool of the church. And then I thought about your winter and the snow and how bloody freezing it would be in the winter. So I thought, okay, well, we'll just have a pile of volunteers and they will build a little house within the church. And this will be a warm, insulated place of healing, which is a place to go, a center for health professionals to be. That need to be tended, that need to be nurtured, that need to be healed. Because we're identifying lots of people around the city who are flourishing, happy health professionals that have got something to give us, something to teach us. So I had this kind of idea of this little house of compassion that was built and was sitting within an old church. And I'm not suggesting this as a physical reality, but I'm just suggesting this to you as a metaphor, because I think we need these little houses of compassion. I think in every single encounter with a patient, we need to make space for that little house of compassion, that place where we can create some stillness, some presence, some compassion, caring. Create a space of healing for the patient to step into. That in every relationship between a faculty and a student, we need a little house of compassion. In every relationship between a boss and an employee, we need a little house of compassion. In every relationship between a payer and a provider, we need a little house of compassion. In every university, in every school, in every clinic, in every hospital, we need a little house of compassion. And that image has just stayed with me. And our job really is just to be present and not to suggest any ideas, but just to try and... It's just this idea that somehow we need to create sacred places in medicine again. So I'm going to end on that note. I'm going to invite Stephanie Barnett to come up to the stage. She's going to tell you all how you can get involved in what's becoming a movement in the city, how many different organizations are involved in the Vote for Tomorrow. But I want to thank you so much for listening so attentively. Thank you very much.
To build a little house of compassion that Robin and Meredith could live in a couple of months a year. What do you all think? Thank you so much. And Meredith, thank you so much. So we have a responsibility, feel strong responsibility, to take this beautiful raw material and to create something that's sustainable here in our own town. And what I want to say to you all in the audience and to the rest of those who are walking the steps of healing and service to patients, I want to let you know that our community really does have your back. That Compassionate Louisville's healthcare constellation is made up of about 100 and growing leaders who all have a number of ideas on how we can support the growth of these little houses of compassion in our own city. And I imagine several of you, if not all of you, have ideas of the building blocks for those little houses of compassion, either in your workplace, your homes, your teams, your schools. And so tomorrow, we're inviting as many of you builders to join the other members of our healthcare constellation at a celebration and an initiation. We'll be gathering at 6:30 tomorrow, Tuesday, May 19th, and the folks by the doors have flyers with more information. To celebrate the gift of the last 6 weeks and also to show our appreciation by activating, by taking some action, identifying some items, some ideas, some projects, some building blocks for those little houses of compassion that we can begin to take on within our own community. 6:30 to 8:30 at the University of Louisville's Get Healthy Now Wellness Center. And we would love for as many of you all to join us and to be part of that building team. So there'll be handouts there. In addition, at the door, these small little acts that we can all take every day. We've got some small cards that I would invite you to take and share with your friends. On one side, there's a hand washing reflection. And so every one of us are responsible for transitioning between patients. And part of what we do is we wash our hands, right? So there's a small reflection that can begin to prepare you and center you for this next precious encounter with the next patient. So I would invite you to take one of those cards and practice this hand washing reflection. On the reverse, there are ways in which you can connect with our work. So links to Compassionate Louisville's website, links to the Facebook page for our healthcare constellation, to the website for our constellation, and also the survey that Robin mentioned is also, the link to that is also on this card. And what if we took that survey? What if we establish a baseline for the happiness and resilience of our community? And what if, as a healthcare constellation, we worked tirelessly to make sure that the results here in Louisville, Kentucky, surpass those of other peer cities? That's what we're here to do. Any of you who are interested in engaging in the work, we've got some projects that are underway already. We expect tomorrow night that there'll be more projects to add to the list. And we would just welcome us as a community to begin to embrace this concept of Louisville, Kentucky being the model city for the happiest, the most resilient health professionals on the planet. And I think that we're very close. We've certainly been seeded with excellent evidence, with excellent motivation, and with a community that already supports us. So please join us and see me if you need more information. Thank you.
Thank you, Stephanie Barnett. Eloquent as always. So we have about 10 minutes until the official closing time. I'm really happy to take any questions or comments.
Thank you very much. Could you comment on the influence of the electronic health record on the opportunity to provide compassionate care?
So the question is, I'm not sure that mic was working, but the question is, can I comment on the impact of the electronic health record on the ability to practice compassionate care? We've heard quite a lot about that in the last 6 weeks. People are pretty vocal about what a huge imposition that is. I've seen research showing that ER doctors now spend 44% of a shift filling out their EMR and only 28% of the shift actually face-to-face with patients, and that's become burdensome. Clearly, the system has got kind of crazy. It's, you know, in our many visits to Louisville over the past 3 years, and examining the USA healthcare system, comparing it with our own in New Zealand, we see a number of things that seem pretty crazy, like an EMR that is such a burden on providers. And we've tended to believe that there's this crazy system out there that's just ruining our lives and making, you know, making compassionate care really difficult. But Stephanie talks about the love triangle, she calls it, between the providers, the payers, and the patients. And the providers and the payers don't trust each other, and the patients and the providers don't trust each other, and the patients and the providers don't trust each other. And I've begun to wonder whether the imposition of more and more need to micromanage, to control, and so on, is actually just a symptom of a profound lack of trust. And what would happen if we brought more compassion to those relationships? What would happen if we built more trust between the providers and the payers so that they didn't require us to do tick boxes? So that's one thought I have. The other thought I have is that we've met many physicians who work in exactly the same system, who have joyful practice and somehow get by. And sometimes they make a choice to see just a little fewer patients in a day and spend more time. And they still have the burdens of the EMR and everything else, but they still always find time to make care. So we're kind of struck with this idea of the compassion rebels. I met a physician just the other day who works in integrative medicine. And she took up a contract within the last 2 years, and they sat down to negotiate the terms of contract and said, "Doctor, we need to talk about your productivity goals." And she said, "Thank you very much, but I'm not having that discussion. You know, I care for whole people, and productivity does not rate in my view of how medicine should be, so I'm not having that discussion. And if you're going to persist with that, then I'm not taking this job." "Oh, no, doctor, we really want you." So they gave her a job, and a month later, someone came and said, "We really need to talk to you about your productivity goals." And she said, "Well, you know, we agreed we were not going to have that conversation. And if you're going to persist with this, I'm going to quit now, so you can just go away now." So they went away. And then 3 months later, they came back and, "No, we really need to talk to you." And she said, "Well, can we just agree we're not going to ever have this conversation again? Because either I quit right now, or you agree that we're not going to have this conversation." And she said, "Why are my colleagues so helpless? If a few more doctors stood up and said, 'Well, I'm not going to sign that agreement,' then that agreement would not exist." So it's very easy to be blaming of another party that's forcing on us all these rules, regulations, and so on. But, you know, what part can we play in addressing that and building some more trust and allowing people to give us a bit more room? And the other thought I have is that the organizations that just make life hell for health professionals aren't going to exist that much longer. And organizations like Birdsog in the Netherlands that provide an opportunity for health professionals to exercise their judgment, work autonomously, care in a proper way with dramatically better results at less cost, are going to grow and flourish, and everyone's going to move from one organization to the other. So there is a process of evolution. So those are my thoughts on it. But, you know, we've heard a great deal about the frustration, so I really empathize with, you know, your concerns about that. That was a long answer, wasn't it?
The only way to handle that, though, is on a larger basis, to just say slow down. I mean, calling your congressman, union organizations, joining the physician groups to talk to your congressman and to talk to government officials about that. Otherwise, the individual practitioner feels helpless.
Yeah, sure. I think we need to, the first rule is let's be compassionate. Let's be compassionate in our work. Let's not be blaming. Let's try and understand what it's like to be in the payer's office. Any other questions or comments? I love this, reflective silence. When does this happen? And no one's getting up to leave either. Yeah. Thank you. I'm really happy to turn the microphone off and have some more private conversations with people if you want to just talk in a small group. If there's no other questions or comments, we're going to declare this a success and invite you all to come and join us tomorrow. Thank you. Thank you for raising the issue. It's extremely vexing.
So when we started to get the electronic health record,
yeah,
they had a group of users called the users group for the doctors to get to have input into the record. We had a meeting,